Every year, Startup Grind hosts our SG Women Leaders Month, proudly recognizing the accomplishments of successful women leaders all over the world. These women are founders, venture capitalists, engineers, executives, educators, and more who represent our community all around the world. This month's SG Women Month is proudly presented by Google for Startups and Silicon Valley Bank.
Meeta ma'am, thank you very much. We will start with our first question that has been going around in all our heads. In the last 3 months, I think March 22nd was when the Janta lockdown started, and then passenger air travel got, halted. And since that day, there has been a huge surge in IT adoption across the country. And as NIC, what have you seen from the other side? How has it all changed? What has been different, and how has the last 3 months been for you?
Oh, it has been quite challenging, but at the same time, a lot of good experiences also we had. See, when this lockdown happened, not only that people could not move, there were restrictions of movement. At the same time, government had an additional duty of managing this pandemic as well as managing the movement of essential goods and all other planning for the situations to come. It was also, if you remember, about end of the financial year. So a lot of closing of the accounts and all have to be done. So a lot of work happened in terms of, people used to once in a while work from home, but here now you have to enable a lot of people to be working from home and working from home, working on their own. So our ICT, as you know, as an IC, we provide ICT infrastructure for the government. We have exclusive ICT infrastructure set up for the government, which is spanned from pan-India high-speed secure network from central government to state government going down to district administration. As you know, we have presence with 800 offices with every state capital in every district of India. And through this infrastructure, we provide video conferencing services, messaging services, email services, and also at the same time, data center services and cloud services. Many of these services really came across a exponential rise in terms of number of users as well as the usage of these services, particularly email, messaging, some of the existing platforms, which were used for transfer of benefits to the beneficiaries or the people who were in distress at that time, really went under a lot of. Fortunately, we had this cloud infrastructure, therefore scaling up was really good and enabling people to work from home. I really thank all my NIC colleagues. They have worked more than what they were working in their routine days to be able to cater to these demands of new requirement because people are working from their homes. Lot many issues were coming initially before it stabilized. But it was very good to see that not only we could very satisfactorily help government close the financial year, we could also help enable people or the government in terms of transfer of these benefits. What was very encouraging to see was that during this time, we also saw a lot of adoption of technology by the citizens, which was very, very encouraging experience. And these citizens were across urban and rural landscape of India, whether it is availing services online, whether digital payments, or whether engaging with the government for various kinds of things. So that was something I felt, I always say in all these tough times, which each one of us is in one way or other going through, one thing which has happened good is the significance and role of technology. Perhaps technology is the one thing which has really helped us address some of these challenges in our professional, personal, as well as public discourse. So overall, it has been good, though stressful, but I think at the end, if we have to do something for citizens, it's always very satisfying.
Okay. So I want to, on a lighter note, I wanted to ask you, how many of the weekends have you worked straight? Were you working through Saturdays and Sundays all through?
Oh, yes. I have gone to office every day. It's okay. It's a part of... it's not because of these things. Otherwise, also, the kind of job we have, we are supporting every central and state government. Some other priority is always there. So, that's okay. That's not a problem.
Okay. So, this is an unprecedented time, right? It has never happened before. I don't think there was any plan around it that you know, organizations and governments had. It's a lesson for all startups. It's a lesson for all companies on how do you scale up? And we are not talking about scaling up in 5 branches with, say, 10,000 customers or 1,000,000 customers. We are talking about 800 offices that are at central, state, district, and Panchayat Raj levels, if I'm not wrong. And as an ICT arm of the government, that's a huge challenge servicing 130 crore population. So how did you make it happen under your leadership? How did the team get to accomplishing such a feat?
I must give the full credit to my team. It's their motivation and their commitment, particularly if you look at my district offices. You know, each of district offices, you only have 2 offices. Mm-hmm. And these offices, I always call them, they are corona warriors, you know, because they have been working with this day and they give complete IT support to district administration, district collector, and all other district level health authorities, surveillance authorities. They're the one who've been 24/7 that for the last 4 months, 3 months, they've been running the services and giving all kinds of supports, whether it is video conferencing, arranging within the government. You have seen in during this time, Prime Minister had interacted with so many segments of society and everybody was operating from their home, more or less, you know. Connecting, even arranging one conference like this, bringing everybody on board, it, on the ground, a lot of work had to be done. So a lot of credit to all these officers at the district, at the state level, and particularly our ICT infrastructure team, because see, people could not move much. Many of the people in Delhi live in NCR. Very often you used to see the borders used to close. There was initial 1 week or 2, we were not even an essential service, we were not listed. So movement itself used to be a huge exercise to make vehicles and all those things arranged. And running this complete data centers and cloud and then cater to these kind of exponential rise in requirements was a challenge. One thing I think, since we had a robust infrastructure, we had a lot of redundancy already built in, and we also had this lot of these major citizens facing applications are already cloud enabled. So quickly scaling up was possible because the basic ingredients were in place.
So the architecture allowed.
But yes, for the team. Yeah, yeah. In fact, you know, as an IC for the last 3 years or so, we have been really focusing to make most of our applications a kind of a web scale application. Our first encounter was when we did MyGov. I mean, that time, for the first time, we were suddenly had an application where you have, I mean, kind of concurrency we had actually not seen before. So a lot of learning happened that thing, and encouraged by that, whatever programs for the last 4 or 5 years have been done in under Digital India, many of them by design are by basic concept have been designed to scale, and they have all those basic attributes in place through which you can easily scale them out or scale up depending on what is the requirement. And that really helped, that basic preparation which was there. And we also during this time, you know, kind of did consolidation, because see, we operate in state governments. So there are a lot of applications which every state has to work. So should we have 35 versions of software, or should we only have one national platform? So last 4 or 5 years, we have actually made a mandate that it has to be a product, it has to be a platform, or it has to be software as a service. You cannot do independent projects and solutions. Mm-hmm. A lot of administrative and capacity building arrangements have been done. We've been really focusing on these things. We've been actually telling every state you should have one national level product, you know. And as a result, we now have 20 to 25 products which a single platform works for the entire country. Whether you talk of vehicle registration, or you talk of driving license, mm-hmm. or you talk of e-hospital or e-office, which is our digital office. So all these are kind of platforms. So scaling them becomes far more easier than perhaps if it was 5 years ago, it would have been much more. I don't know. It would have been a real challenge.
Understood. Got it. Now, I think one of the I mean, recent times we have seen Arogya Setu being one of the initiatives by NIC and Government of India that has gathered a lot of interest across the country for the right reasons, right? I think it's never been seen that, you know, in such a short span by, I think, April 2nd, less than 10, 15 days since the lockdown kind of started, you had an app that was market ready. It was available on Play Store and App Store. What was the story? And as a mission head for the Arogya Setu app, how was your experience, you know, fast tracking and accelerating such a app deployment that I think has the country has never seen before?
You know, when in the early days of this coronavirus infection, when it came in the country, we were all planning and working with the various government departments to strengthen their infrastructure, to strengthen their applications or reconfigure them to help them handle the requirements of this, which begin right from testing infrastructure, where you put all this information about the people undergoing tests and what is the outcome of the test, going on to treatment, that means hospitals, what is the kind of inventory they have, how many oxygen beds, how many ventilators, and basically even basic kits for the doctors. You know, at one point, you know, mask itself was not available so easily, and sanitizers. So while we are planning for all, and finally the surveillance part, which is very, very important. Mm-hmm. When we were doing, so one thing which first did that, how do we make this information flow from one system to other system seamlessly? So we developed an API-based exchange and connected all these systems so that in real time, supposing a person has been tested positive, in real time, surveillance officer at the district gets to know that this person in his district has become positive. Similarly, the information reaches to hospitals, and so, and then if surveillance officers does the contact tracing, which are the people to be tested. So this complete IT infrastructure was put. While we were doing all these things, we realized that as the number increased, we see the contact tracing, which is the core function of Arogya Setu, has been traditionally done in any time when you have any disease surveillance system going on. But it was a manual contact tracing. That means if the person who becomes positive, surveillance officer goes and interviews him and then asks in last 10 to 14 days, in the case of COVID, it is 14 days, whom all have you come in contact with? We realized, first of all, this disease is such that the person suddenly gets into a mental state where it may be difficult for him to remember all those things. Mm-hmm. Person may not be in a medically fit state to be able to share all this information. And when numbers increase, it'll be really difficult for the district machinery to be able to contact each one of us. And that is where this idea of contact tracing through technology came in. We also received a number of proposals at our Ministry of Electronics and IT. Some proposals came to us and some proposals came to NITI Aayog at the same time. These were different approaches for the contact tracing. And we had actually evaluated each of these apps or the proposal which was there. That time they were all basic apps doing the basic contact tracing. And very high level committed, the level of secretary and other senior officers were there. So we evaluated on various aspects. And then finally, one of that app was chosen and which was later named as RLTC. Moment this app was chosen, then composite IT team was set up, which had people from the government, from NIC, as well as from industry, some of the people from startups on a voluntary basis, also from academia. We had this core tech team was built, which was given the task of bringing this application from there to the expectation, which was there with us as the government app kind of. And there was then an advisory committee over it where senior officers were there. Then the next 15 days, I should really put on record this team, which was coming from different sectors and from different contexts and from different backgrounds. They all really worked together and they truly worked 24/7 for next 13 to 14 days. And every day, because, you know, we had to see this app. First of all, app which is made for 130 crore people, communication has to be right. Whether it is your advisory which you are giving, whether it is any kind of information you are sharing, the communication and the language and every other aspect has to be seen, looking at the implications of these. Second thing was privacy of the citizens had to be kept in mind, and how should you design the whole thing. Then was the cybersecurity or security aspect of the whole thing. And the most challenging thing is how do you make this app more inclusive so that all these wide variety of phones, old phones, new phones, which is available in India, we should be able to cover as much of a spectrum of smartphones available of whichever gender they are to make this thing, which really had, we really had to go back and forth to introduce features and then, you know, tween them so that we could make this app inclusive while keeping it secure, because that's where, as you know, the security also starts. Older versions will have some, may not have some features, and then the security issues may come up. So all these discussions used to happen, and we really need to have meetings in late nights and give input to these young teams, team which was, all I said, NICN, private and everybody. And really thankful to them that they really came up with expectations and worked very hard to bring this app. And finally, in 15 days, we could finally launch. Then another thing was the language part. Initially, it was in English and Hindi, but we thought we should at least bring in 11 or 12. Initially, when we launched, it was 11 languages.
Right.
And then infrastructure also had to be seen at the back. That at that day, you do not know, what is the cover. Because if you see smartphones, we'll have 400 million smartphones in the country. So a lot of things are there. And when you're trying to put on the Play Store or on the Apple Store, there also the whole kind of process happens when you're doing this kind of thing. It was a big, good learning for all of us. But thanks to the entire team, which really rose up to this challenge. And really happy that today we have this.
I think it's when I saw it, when I was reading through the newspapers, I've heard my friends who are in startups also trying to come up with an app, because it was done earlier in other countries and it worked pretty well. So they were also trying to come up with something. But the pace at which the government rolled out Arogya Setu app in the short period of time, with the kind of, the infrastructure that needs to go into it, that kind of, it really blew my mind, saying, how did a government startup and then corporates, all of them got together at such a short span? It's an example for everyone, right? It's an example of how collaboration can really bring about a massive change that, even in times of crisis. I won't go into the technical details of Arogya Setu, but there is one aspect that really impressed me and I think the whole of the community. There was a lot of debates on privacy, right? I don't know. I mean, there's been back and forth. Twitter kept saying that there are privacy issues. Some hackers said that there was privacy issues. And then there was a, response from the government saying, no, we have checked it. The IIT professors have checked it. We have left it to a bunch of hackers to test it. And all their feedback has been incorporated. But then the final, nail in the coffin kind of a thing happened when you open sourced it. Like, has the government done this before, open sourcing a software like this? Or is it the first time this has been thought of? And whose idea was this?
See, it has been over 30 years of my career in government. First of all, I had never seen an app which will be launched by 130 million people. It itself was a kind of a very, very pleasant shock to me. I think one thing we should also remember, it became so widespread. One reason was also that it was supported by none other than our Honorable Prime Minister. He himself urged people that, and used a kind of appeal he carries with the citizens. So that was one thing. Second thing, as you rightly said, it was a very beautiful experience of public-private partnership kind of a thing, where people voluntarily came up and in this time, testing times, and really worked together. It's easy to say, even if you bring four people from four different backgrounds and four different setups, and you ask them to work together, and they were all working from different cities, as I said, they've never kind of met them physically, it is quite relatable. And it's very encouraging, because it also gives us a kind of a very encouraging experience, which perhaps can be taken into future endeavors of the government, because we're very proud of a very vibrant IT industry and very, very dynamic startup community. So I think this is also something which is very encouraging for all of us to do works in partnerships and come up with these kinds of examples. Now, see, the day one, as I told, when we had selected the app, I only know, how many hours we spend to make sure that there is no privacy issue in this thing. Because, you know, our ministry, I was also part of it, who had written this personal data protection bill, which is in parliament nowadays. Mm-hmm. So we were all aware what are the things. So we had actually said the best thing will be a few things like Bluetooth or location. This had to be captured. Without this, we cannot do. So best thing will be very, very transparent. That what are we capturing? How are we processing this information? What is that we will carry to the server? So we had a very, very well-defined, very clearly defined privacy policy and terms and conditions which were included in this case. Second thing, the approach was very, very minimalistic. Only capture the data which is needed and transfer to the server only data which is really needed. So only when the person turns positive, then only. So you see it's 130 million people and only in few lakhs only, I mean less than that, we have taken the data to the server. Only of those people. All those things we time and again, I mean I think each one, even our senior officers, at all forums, we first time, you know, we proactively went to all these media channels and explained people that this is how it works and it is very transparent and it's very secure at the same time, because even the security encryption standards at rest in transmit in while transit of this thing or at the server were all kept. That the policy for purging the data after certain days were also announced, and all this was done. And more or less people were satisfied, but still there were some concerns coming from here and there, which is I fully understand. So then we thought, during our senior level deliberations, this idea came up, why not open the code? See, it's not a question of opening code. When application, you know, when you have done in just 15 days, many a times your source code may not have been that well written. It may not have been documented so well, because when you're doing almost things. So, but before you release, you need to really clean it. You need to really document it well so that people unnecessarily if they don't understand well and then kind of start raising the question. So that was the work which was even not getting time because of the kind of pressure. Because app, you know, even today we keep having discussion and saying that how to take it forward with the new features or how do you refine. Because as you know, pandemic situation and the various advisories of the government are also changing time because everybody is seeing it for the first time. So we also have to tune our app in consonance with this. And as you're rightly saying, as far as government is concerned, this is the very, very first time in India, I'm sure, that any app source code has been made open. So it was, I'm glad because, you know, doing so, all those concerns of citizens have been taken care. And I, as I have so far understood that they have they're really satisfied with all this being open and all those concerns which were there for some people. They have also publicly appreciated the effort. And then we thought, in any case, you know, we have put in our best, but we have a bright young professionals in our country. Maybe they will be able to find some vulnerability. And if they find some vulnerability, let us know. We should be ready to fix it onto this. Therefore, to make this, and also sometimes we've written a code, maybe there is a better way of writing the same code. So that is also, we announced this bug bounty program to channelize their energy into a right way, and so that, and we also get benefited in the end by this whole exercise. So which has been done, and where for the security purposes, with a well-defined statements have been given that if you could find any vulnerability in these areas, or if you have any suggestions for code improvement. So that bug bounty was announced that people could really, enthusiastic and all these bright youngsters could really look at it and give us some suggestions to which at the end with a common mission, see at the end, all of us are working in one way or other to contain the spread of this virus and save ourselves, save our community and save our country. So it's been going on. I mean, I was just checking with my team prior to this, around 2,000 entries have been submitted. We are now going to evaluate and then take it forward. So I think it's been a very collaborative exercise.
This is another aspect, right? I was about to come to that question. I've heard Silicon Valley tech giants talking about bug bounty programs. And then it's only in the startup space, the successful Indian startups like Ola, Paytm, who have come across and said, you know, we are going to do a bug bounty. We're going to pay 1 lakh rupees if you find something. And suddenly the government has started absorbing this initiative. So my question is this the first of many more bug bounties to come across more products? And, you know, how do you see this strengthening the whole infrastructure of, you know, of India in terms of involving more people into this? Is this a more of a philosophy that is slowly evolving within the NIC?
Yes, I think this philosophy, not only in NIC as a government, you see there have been a lot of initiatives where we are seeing how do we really involve our industry and particularly our startup community to really make our solutions more innovative, more inclusive, and to be really serving India as a whole. So number of times we've been kind of discussing these things. And in not really bug bounty, but you see, we've been running this. If you see, in last 3 to 4 years, number of hackathons government has done, Ministry of HRD has done, then Ministry of Defence had run the hackathon. We at NIC around open data program have been running hackathons. Their prizes were kind of there, and it basically to have some mechanism of participation. And I think. And as you know, in government, we do a lot of work on. Our philosophy is open source. A whole lot of work we do in open source, and we've been always, in fact, for the last few months, maybe a year, we've been deliberating that how do we really partner with these startups and bring them in our fold to be able to. So we have this government e-marketplace. Some months ago, even there, and a provision was done where these startups could register, and a lot of relaxations were done. But I'm sure that there's much more which needs to be done. So, and I feel this kind of initiative and this kind of a partnership will make more government departments really assure them to get into these kinds of partnerships. And I hope we have, I strongly believe that in the months to come, it will you'll see a lot of initiatives in this direction. Since you are mentioning, immediately after this, video conferencing is another thing, you know, which now everybody needs, whether work from home or government and all. You'll be surprised to know that since this lockdown has happened, our VC team is supporting over 1,000 to 1,200 VCs per day. Mm-hmm. And still there is a lot of unmet demand which we've not been able to meet. And so people said that, why are we going to all these tools, why can't we have VC tools made in India itself? So even today, as we're talking, a challenge is going on for all the startups where they can make a VC solution. And this time, these challenges very well designed. It does not really finish on you winning the prize. It goes further and sees a long-term arrangement with these startups so that whatever product they have built, they continue to support for some time. And at the same time, some kind of a business model could adapt, some government departments could use it. So we're now trying to see, we're also maturing, you know, in these kinds of initiatives and seeing that how do we make best out of these partnerships. So there is a lot of intent, and I hope to see a lot more in the future.
Awesome. So we will move on from the whole COVID thing and let's talk about in general about NIC and what it's been doing. So for the first time in our country's history, we have access to technology at the most bottommost level, right? At almost, you know, negligible cost, there is internet and there is two-way communication on phones and IVRS systems. E-governance is one of the core motive that, you know, a large country like ours need to have to scale up and to actually support the whole government. What do you think are the challenges and opportunities out there, ma'am, in terms of last generation didn't have access to them, but this generation it's everywhere. Parents have access to smartphones and people in villages, rural India also has access to smartphones. How is this shaping up the country from the NIC's view?
I think we are in the middle of very, very exciting times, as I always tell my colleagues, you know, because the broadband penetration as well as mobile penetration is at its best nowadays, and we are seeing it's continuously improving as infrastructure is also improving. And also, if you look at it during these times, people have also shown a lot of courage. I mean, the kind of adoption of technology during these times, maybe we were all thinking they will not adapt it so easily. You look at school children of primary classes have started having their classes on phones, I mean, which is, and mobile has been a real boon to our country. It has, in fact, I always say, it's much bigger than the computer which we have in our homes. And the small children I see around, even my home, people who work for us, even their children, I mean, suddenly they know WhatsApp, they know YouTube, and they know meeting and video conferencing. So the day they have taken is one thing. Second thing, if you look at telemedicine, we have seen so much of a teleconsultation happening, which we have always, you know, been saying for India, for health to be provided to all in the affordable and quality health in the country, we really need these technology tools to be really materializing. A far more adoption has to happen. We've seen a lot of adoption, and there, see, these technology platforms were earlier also there. But it is the adoption by the citizen, the public, which is something we all have to give due credit to them. In terms of payments, if you look at, a lot of digital payments transactions have increased like anything. So as a government, if I look at it, I feel in government, we should now kind of make by default all our services contactless, faceless, and paperless, and cashless. So cashless, faceless, and paperless, if we could make these services where citizens could avail all services over, they don't have to, if they need to go into the government office to avail a service, should be eliminated onto this thing. And today, and there, not only this, and we have a lot of emerging technologies coming, like this conversational AI. You know, you must have seen a lot of chatbots have come up in private sector as well as in government during this time. And they are, as the time is passing, it's beautiful to see they are becoming so natural that, you know, you feel that sometimes it's really a pleasant experience interacting with them. So if you could really have a lot of this conversational AI coming in government, that too in Indian languages, it will really make the connect of the citizen with the government remotely a very, very pleasant experience. They can ask 10 times the same question and the chatbot will answer. And that way, that the engagement of the citizen with government will also improve. So that's another thing I feel and I hope a lot will happen. You'll be surprised to know that we developed during this time, we have Center of Excellence on Artificial Intelligence. They have developed a chatbot in as remote as Khasi language, which is in Meghalaya state, you know, and it became a big hit. And I'm sure a number of other initiatives, other departments and private sector is taken. And these chatbots were earlier also there, or voice bots were also there. But during this time, when you did not have an option of moving out or going to an office, but you still had to avail a service, so you started using it. Citizens from all over started using it. And they are also, I think, more confident to now have services online than walking into government offices and all. So I see a lot of these services going fully online with cashless facility in the days to come.
Okay. So you've been, you've been the backbone for many of these initiatives, right? You were crucial in the Digital India program, and MyGov, DigiLocker, eHospital, a lot of them came in. One of my favorites is MyGov. It was, I think, for the first time, the government was actually trying to crowdsource ideas on governance from the whole community. And I see a lot of my friends and a lot of other startups actively discussing about, you know, the people have stopped reading newspapers, people have stopped actually participating in these discussions. But MyGov gave that opening and said, okay, this is what the government is doing and this is what is happening. So that whole transparency part of having a MyGov and a voice for the government, how did that shape up, Neeta ma'am?
This was actually a direction from none other than Honorable Prime Minister that we should have a platform to engage with this. I mean, if you remember, it came as early as 2014. I mean, I'm not remembering the date, but within a few months, we were asked to make this platform set up. I think May and July somewhere we kind of launched it. So it was really a direction from him. He had a lot of experience as a chief minister in Gujarat, and from there he gave us this direction. And it has been a good experience. We had done some public consultations or certain policies. I don't know whether you people were at that time, must be very young when this IT software policy came in India, and there was an IT task force set up way back in 1988-99. That time also we had done public consultation and asked people from India and all over how this whole software industry should move. And we that time, of course, we only had email as a mechanism to get input. So those consultations, but they were very, very targeted on certain topics. MyGov really became a platform for everything and anything which we need public's input. I mean, as you know, not only policy input, lot of crowdsource in terms of ideas, lot of logos and major government programs, whether it is Swachh Bharat, whether it is Digital India itself, or Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao, or Jan Dhan program, all these logos also have come through that crowdsource mechanism. So it's a beautiful platform and real opportunity for government to interact with citizens.
The second most influential aspect among the Digital India program for me is the e-courts. Is this the new era of accelerated judicial system? The kind of things that can open up because of e-courts is just massive, right? People always keep complaining about the paperwork that is involved in judicial system. But how is this going to change the whole landscape of our country?
See, e-courts, we have been working since 2005. It's a very, very long journey through which we have come through. And today, I mean, and of course, it is done in the direction of the e-committee under the ambit of Supreme Court, who guides us and who really helps us rolling out all these great ideas which we come through. So we have today a common software which works in all subordinate courts in India, across, which is around 20,000 courts across, the common software which works. And as a result, today we have National Judicial Data Grid, on which all 10 crore cases, around 3 crore cases which are already disposed of, and the remaining which is in this thing, the complete data of that is available on this thing. It's a very, very valuable resource for all those litigants, lawyers, students, researchers in this domain. It is also a very good tool because it has a lot of analytics domain and all for the judicial officers or for the honorable judges to see how is the particular court performing, which are the domains is doing well, where are the places they can do further improvement and things. Similarly, we have a common platform working in high courts of India. 22 high courts we have common software working. That's another part. What you have seen is, so what these used to do, as a result of these automation in these courts, at any point of time, the moment some judgment or some hearing has happened, the complete proceedings or the orders used to be available on the website or on their portals immediately. What is the court cases to be listed tomorrow, day after, cause list, which they call. This all is going on for quite some time, and all this information is in digital form. What has happened recently is what you have heard is e-courts to virtual courts we have gone. This is where we are trying to say, with so much of our automation now, we should have a mechanism where we should reduce even the visit of litigants or lawyers to the court. This is not because of the COVID. COVID became, it got impetus during COVID. But our 1 year ago, we had done the first virtual court with Delhi High for the traffic challan cases. You know, when you have traffic challan, we have this e-challan system through which traffic cop right on the spot can, you know, scan your driving license or your vehicles or your driving car's number and can fix a challan, and you can digitally pay. You don't have to go any place. Challan doesn't have to come to you. There are also certain violations on which you are expected to go to the court, and then in front of the judge you have to make certain consent and then make a payment. Often, you know, I had heard my friends, family saying, oh, for that paying 500 rupees. Earlier fines were not that high, you know. So 500 rupees I have to take off from office and then go and stand there, and maybe that day number doesn't come. So everybody was keen to pay that money, but that whole effort of going to the court and then making that payment was a huge issue. And then we saw some statistics, and we saw most of the time people are more than keen to pay because they know they've done this particular thing. if the percentage in which they kind of contest, no, I mean, this, I have not done this violation, was far less. So therefore, we converted this whole process to a digital virtual court, where moment the traffic cop has put in a challan, and it is a challan which cannot be paid on the spot, and then it just goes to the virtual court. Virtual judge also need not be in the court. On his, he has an access to the system. He can decide that this is a kind of system test under which section and what is the maximum fine this person, this particular offense has. And looking at all context, he or she will decide this is the fine, and that is being communicated on a message to the citizen, and citizen then pays online. If he wishes to contest, then only the case goes there. So this is a simple system where we felt that only one judicial officer could handle all of Delhi courts and could handle 4,000 to 5,000 cases one day, where he needs to have multiple courts to handle this. And it not only reduced pendency, it also gave a lot of convenience to citizens, and it also increased government's revenue of 94-95 crores they could collect in this 1 year through this challan payment itself. So neither, and now in this COVID times, neither the judge has to go to the court, neither the litigant has to go to, neither the lawyer has to go to the court, and the case gets settled. And by encouraged by this, now during this COVID time, you know, if you know now daily you have CCTV cameras, and CCTV cameras also capture your violation. Earlier, because that in between needed somebody to see whether if there is any false positive or so. Now that system also has been integrated with the virtual courts, and everything happens again in the same fashion. And encouraged by this, now 5 more courts in India have followed, and in the time, I think in the months to come, we'll have many more courts adopting, because they are seeing the true value of it. We are also trying to see that how could we extend this facility to many other such offenses where procedure is simple and convert into virtual courts. So I think not only this is seeing lot of value in the social distance and all these restricted movement thing, but in the time to come, because if we will save judiciary from this routine kind of cases, they can handle other cases, and the whole judicious justice delivery in the country perhaps could be expedited. So that's the basic philosophy behind. Another thing which you've seen nowadays, I mean, I must really thank Honorable Supreme Court, that Supreme Court, since COVID lockdown happened, has been continuing its court hearings and court judgments using video conference. Not only they started using it, they've advised all the courts. Today, around 8 to 10 parallel courts run on video conference in Supreme Court on a regular basis. So that's something really, really remarkable. This video conference infrastructure we had set up for the courts, you know, to make these hardcore criminals to be appearing for the court hearings from the jails itself. So that, you know, because the whole effort of bringing them from the courts and the complete protection given used to be a lot of exercise for the police. So therefore, this whole system was set up. But today, the same video conferencing infrastructure is being used for public at large. So it's I think judiciary is going through a lot of digital transformation, and I really strongly believe that this is really going to expedite justice delivery in the country, for which many a times people have to suffer along.
Got it. So I have my next question on open government data, but I want to take a pause and just, you know, understand the scale of what NIC is doing, right? We are talking about all government offices and all infrastructure that runs the country at a very high level. What kind of a team, I mean, you should be having a very strong team and a large team to make this happen, right? Can you talk a little bit of the scale of the champions that you have with you, ma'am?
Yes, sure. I mean, if you see from any industry point of view, we do not have very large team, but I'm very proud. I have very, very committed and dedicated team, you know, who are really committed to their work. So if you look at it, we have a headquarters in NIC. And then we have our offices in every state capital who cater to the state government's requirement. And then we have small presence in every district office. In terms of our activity, we are, as you know, as a 40 years old organization set up that time. And over the time, one thing which we have done is set up a huge exclusive ICT infrastructure for the government, which complies with all criteria of security and access and all those things. And the second thing which we did, we built a lot of IT solutions for the government in all every sector for that matter. And third is we kind of advise government that how should they use, continuously explore this, you know, emerging technologies, whether it is blockchain, whether it is artificial intelligence, whether it is data analytics, or whether it is drones, use of drones or robotics, that how this can be used for the social good. So these are the three major areas in which we work. As infrastructure, I have already told you that we have done a lot of consolidation. We have national data centers, all of them largely supporting cloud infrastructure. We have a national cloud for the government, the government's use, on which most of the programs which have been launched under Digital India are supported by this infrastructure. We have teams. And then we have other set of teams who work with every sector, ministry, department, and develop these IT solutions or IT platforms. And of advisory, all our senior people work in an advisory capacity at the same time. And if you look at the solutions, we have a couple of solutions, platforms, which work for the government's internal use. Whether it is our e-office, I mean, time is not much, but which was a big boon for government to work. This has made government files absolutely paperless. And not only within the department, from district to state capital, or to the chief minister, district collector to chief minister, file travels completely digital. So that is a kind of, this is again a cloud-based solution. 452 different government entities are today using this system. Similarly, we have government procurement platform, a common platform used by, I mean, lakhs and lakhs of tenders are being published on this platform every month. Then we have systems to manage internal functioning of like human resource management system, government appraisal system. So these are for the internal functioning. Then we have large number of citizen saving facing system, like e-hospital you mentioned, e-hospital also works. It's a beautiful system which we have over the time consolidated right from public health center to a hospital like AIIMS Delhi and AIIMS Rishikesh use the same system. So very, very generic system that way. Then we have this, what do you call this, employment guarantee, MNREGA, which you see, that system through which this complete rural employment guarantee and the works are being assigned and payments are being done. That's a platform which we have. Swachh Bharat is another program. So all major programs, whether it's fertilizer subsidy, public distribution system is another very important system which we have, in which all these, which has not only has a complete digitized entire set of beneficiaries, fair price shops, and complete, again, cashless payments through this FPS automations, enablement of Aadhaar, which has been a huge support to the government for distribution of these food grains. When migrant laborers were not in their own states, they were in different states. So how do you manage? So technology-wise, you could do all those things in this thing. Our transport register, whether it's vehicle registration or whether it is your driving license, coming on to this challenge, and also your whenever you do this pollution check, the certificate which is issued to you, that system again, the certificate is delivered from our servers. In the education sector, right from your class 12 results, 10 results, 12 results, to all those admissions in all engineering colleges, management colleges, medical colleges, the counseling thing has been a real game changer. I still remember first result when we had done for CBSE, and everybody was so apprehensive. Today, you see, and what these solutions have done, they have kind of brought people, even the rural part or tier two cities, on the same advantage with citizens, but the students in these big cities were there. Today, sitting in their own home, they can choose that this is my first choice, this college, this discipline. when the data gets allocated first round, second day they again can choose and say, no, now let's say this seat is available, I can go. So they get as much empowered as people who are in big cities and have access to all kind of information. So that makes us really happy. And the anxiety of parents, they don't have to take their child from one institute to other street looking for tickets and travels and all those things. Many times people lose because of not able to really afford all those things. So that has been a very, very big this thing. PM Kisan, in which, you know, all this money has been transferred, is again another platform which has been there. DBT, I'm sure you must have heard of. We have a common, what we have been doing during in last 4 to 5 years, we're trying to consolidate our activities because we know we are a small size organization compared to the kind of mandate we have. So we kind of try and consolidate and make one product or one platform and use it across the nation. And we have been successfully able to do 20 to 25 platforms of that order. And because of the cloud, it really helps us scale whenever it is required. So I was telling you this in the vehicle case. Now we are developing a vehicle location tracking system under this Nirbhaya program. So all public transport have been fixed up with some IoT devices, and you can monitor their complete movement, their geolocations, and also come to their rescue in case they have come into some kind of a medical accident or any kind of a breakdown has happened. So that is another program. Finance being, as I was telling you today, if any government program has to give money to the citizens, irrespective of whether they have their accounts in national banks, private banks, or rural banks, or even post office banks, they just tell this our system, this is the name and this is the bank account number, and their job is complete exchange of Indian and transit fund to the citizens' bank account is this common system take care. So see that the because of these common platforms and common engines, developing any IT solution in government has become far more easier. Similarly, if you want to do payment gateways, all those connections and systems are available. We also have a low-code platform called Service Plus, where you, at least a no-code platform. Thousands of services are being enabled simply by, because if you all are tech specialists, you will understand, most of the government services have a simple form to be filled in, and then you give your information, and they give a workflow at the back, and finally some reports or some certificates or some money will be transacted at the end of it. So we have built up a platform called Services where you configure your application and your applications. Using this platform, within a span of week 10 days, we could give e-pass application to 21 states in the country, which was needed for the movement of not only essential goods, vehicles who had to carry the essential commodities, also the citizens who had to move for some medical reasons, for various kinds of medical emergencies, had to move across within the state, also across the states. So this whole e-pass system just came up it's kind of an on-demand solution for everyone. So that's what has been our focus on. Having said this, we also have a large number of people working from industry with us on an in-source and outsource method, who are an extended part of our teams, who kind of give us first level, second level support, whether it is infrastructure management or it is, the software development project. So overall, small team, very committed team, but at the same time, a lot of support from the industry at the same time. Put together, I think we've been trying to deliver our best, whatever we can.
Awesome. So let's talk about the future, ma'am, for some time. You have been investing your time in a lot of emerging technologies, right? The most recent one that we have come across is the Center of Excellence that you have established in Bangalore, right? So what is your take on these technologies changing e-governance, and what is your vision on these emerging technology being part of what NIC does in the future?
So if you see the last 1.5 years, we have set up three centers of excellence. One was centers on data, and that's really doing well. And particularly during this COVID time, you must have seen a lot of our centers have really done a lot of dashboards and data analytics platform, predictive analytics, that how much will be the estimate inventory needed, whether it is hospital or whether it is the testing kits and things like this. And as a result, and this center has been really working with various government departments to make them appreciate use of data analytics. So far, largely these projects were on a dashboard kind of a thing or visualization kind of a thing, what kind. But I think now with this all experiences, we are going to see a lot of predictive analytics happening, a lot of prescriptive analytics happening, that you know, what is that going to come? What will be the requirement of this team in the times to come? A lot of that culture I am hoping, and I've already told that team to gear up for that kind of a future demand in terms of resources and things like this. So analytics is one thing which will have. Analytics combined with AI is another thing which we will see. Conversational AI, I have already spoken with you. Lot of government activities where AI will come, especially when it comes to image analytics. Like I'll tell you, one of our team is doing a very modest experience. I didn't want to really mention much since you have told. Is, you know, looking at these X-rays, how can you really do, a machine can, by some kind of a deep learning or machine learning, can come up and say that this person seems to be a COVID positive. Because as you know, we have to live with this COVID for next few months or maybe even after that. So early and right prediction of the person is something which is, let's say, we always say that if you can reach the hospital, the people have calculated at what day of the infection you have reached, that kind of determines your outcome in terms of fatality or you've been saved. So the time to come when people will go across to these smaller towns and run through these various X-rays and all, which could be for anything. And if there this engine could be implanted and it could say it looks like to be a COVID case, because not many lives could be saved. So that's one, image analytics. And now, you know, we had a lot of these biometrics systems. Our attendance system is there. Aadhaar is there. There again, now this touch is becoming be containing an issue. So a lot of work is happening. How do you do phase-based analytics and FRS and all those things? We'll see a lot of application of that coming government in the times to come. And blockchain, which I personally believe has a lot of potential to be applied for government applications, because it really gives you the trusted supply chain or trusted this thing of any government document. With that, we believe only we have set up in our center of excellence in Karnataka. With Karnataka, we have a strong team. The couple of applications which we are going to see very soon is, first of all, you see all these academic certificates you have. And you know how many times, how many copies you have to give. You have to give them attested and all those things. So if you could put all of them, and then those challenge of, you know, duplicates and fraudulent practices are also there. If you could put all of this into blockchain and kind of give a service to the student, only refer that number and you are done with, and that'll be a huge service. But my favorite example is this drug supply chain, because we all know the kind of spurious thing in this is happening. And so if you could really establish transparency in this complete supply chain of drugs in India, using, and which we can definitely do through blockchain, I think it'll be a big service to the citizens if they can really get to know how has this medicine and from which source has come. We've already applied this application because some of the states, this spurious liquor is also a problem which many people lose life because of this. So in Goa and other states, we have a very powerful system in West Bengal where complete supply chain of liquor has been, light from morsels to the bottle, you know, has been completely automated. So we're trying to now apply these blockchain technologies there and see that how can we give this trusted or complete this thing, transparency into the complete cycle as the product moves. These are a few applications I've seen. And once we are successful in doing a couple of states, it'll be very easy to roll out across all states. Another thing which I feel in the time to come will in any case, one is because of this health is this IoT devices, medical electronics, integration of, or even in the agriculture sector, integration of these devices, including drones, is another domain really needs to be explored, because we really need to help our farmers in the time to come to make, and this will be one of the thing in making India Atmanirbhar. That's another domain, a lot of work needs to be done. So a lot of scope for emerging technologies in governance, and they can really, in addition to giving convenience to citizen, I feel they have potential to do a lot of innovation, lot of things in the way which we could not do so far. So that's where I think exploration should happen. I look forward to ideas from everybody who's participating and interacting to take it.
So here is a question from all of us, because we are all startup enthusiasts and startup founders. There are a lot of startup founders who are working on ideas in blockchain and a lot of these emerging technologies. How can we help NIC, or how can NIC help us expose our ideas and help the country in return?
Sure. I think we can have a separate discussion on this with some of you who are there and always can take forward. There could be many ways. As I said, GeM is one platform, government e-marketplace where startups could register and then we could use their services. We could also, I mean, in case you all feel there are some pressing problems which as a country will have a large scale applications, we can do some kind of hackathons around it and kind of work out a scheme through which we could have a long-term arrangement. There are many ways through which I think the engagement could happen.
Awesome. Last question, the open data, open government data platform. So there is so much of information that flows through all these systems across, the various government offices, right? What was the motivation behind making it open, ma'am? Where do you see that converging? What is the value that you want to bring back to the country by making this data open?
See, the philosophy was very simple. All this data is being collected using taxpayers' money, and what government uses it is only uses for a very, very limited purpose for which it collects. And it was felt that a lot of this data has far more potential than what it has been used by the government. And third thing is, when we analyze this data over the years, we also have some kind of a set thinking against which we analyze this data. But maybe if you make it open, it can be analyzed from different perspectives. We may get some so valuable insights for which we may not have ever thought of. So these were the ideas basically. And also another thing which I do personally, because when I was doing my research and all, a PhD and all, I realized that these research scholars spend about one and a half year, designing that questionnaire and then creating the sample data on which they will, a lot of energy goes. So I thought, in case I can make this data available in 3 years, they can do far more valuable and far more genuine, I should not say genuine, far more value creation during their research than just spend time on this data collection and requesting you and me that fill up my questionnaire, So that, I thought this could be another big help for all these researchers. And as a country, we could really increase our research quotient, have more patents and have more research publications, which gives us edge as far as our science and technology quotient is concerned.
Awesome.
Plus, it is also very helpful for you just have to give me 1 minute. I think my battery is running down. Just give me 1 second.
Sure, ma'am.
Yeah, really sorry for that.
That's all right.
Yeah. So, what I was saying is that even for, this all this data journalism which is happening, they could also have access to data and then do their own bit of stories and things.
Got it.
Hi, Yash. Yes.
So we will take
the question to ma'am.
Hold on.
Okay.
So we will take a Q&A, like 4 or 5 questions from our participants, ma'am, and then we can, you know, we can see how we'll take it forward. Go on, Vikas.
Thank you. Yes. Thanks a lot. And again, amazing session from Startup Grind. Thanks a lot. And good evening, ma'am. I run a blockchain startup, and when you mentioned about the document verification on blockchain, I got starry-eyed because I'm actually beating the drum from last almost 1.5 years about it, and we have built a solution, and we have paying customer on that, and we are also evangelizing that this, and we recently got accepted under T Block, and we are actually we are evangelizing blockchain as a product which can be used in India because it should be used for transparency, ma'am. So I think part question has been already asked by Yash, but I wanted to actually give you an update that Jam does not allow our product to be listed there. We have tried that on Jam. So that is one thing that I want to bring it into your notice directly via this forum. And second, ma'am, what are the much more direct ways by which we can actually get directly in front of Nick, NIC, and offer our help and like expertise? Because just to put things in perspective, I am India's first blockchain trainer on quite a few platform. In 2016, I have been like doing this thing. So that's my question, ma'am. How can we as a startup who has the expertise can actually get in front of you and showcase that? Thank you, Yash. Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you.
No, Vikas, first of all, congratulations for doing such a good work in such an emerging technology. You're based in Hyderabad or in Bangalore?
Ma'am, Hyderabad was my second home. I was there. I learned everything there in Hyderabad itself for 16 months. But right, I'm based out of Ghaziabad.
Now, so it's very close, I think. So you can,
I think you can
write to me on my address, and I'll definitely connect you to the right people. And I'll also connect to the people in GEM. And let's see how do we take it forward. We surely can find somewhere.
Thank you, ma'am. Thanks a lot.
Mr. Divakar Singh, do you have a question?
Yeah. Are you able to hear me, ma'am?
Yes,
hello, are you able to hear me? Yeah, yeah.
See,
thank you so much. Yeah, thank you so much. It's a great session. A lot of action last 50, 70 days, and it's a great application. Actually, I represent one startup from UK, which built a distance scanning code called V-Code. With the help of that, we can scan an individual, like the code, from 2 to 3 meter distance. And based on that, we built an application which shows the resource health status. That means the protocol for green and red can be defined. So anyhow, we are giving the health process during early stage of this one. Can we extend this kind of a thing for providing health pass, which can show the health status with a stipulated period, and then they have to go through a protocol to get it again green, so that we will have only healthy resources can move around in the organization, in the public transports and other things, and which gives you the status of the people. It's kind of an exploration. I'm just asking, is it possible like that?
Yeah, it's very much possible. In fact, Aarogya Setu itself has a system of a QR code. If you have an Aarogya Setu, it gives you a QR code. If anyone scans your QR code, it conveys your health status. Obviously, all that mechanism of consent and all has to be built up into this. But you please have a look at that QR code, and you think if you can add value further to Aarogya Setu, you can always write to us.
Yes, I will share it with you, ma'am. We have a model. I will share it with you. Can I have the email address?
I think these organizers will share the email address.
Okay, sure. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Any more questions from the participants? Okay, so I think we can close it, ma'am. I'll end this with one quick note. I think in the history of NIC, I see that you've been the director general at a time when, you know, it expected a lot from the DG. And I'm so happy that I got the opportunity to talk to you, and the whole community is very thankful that you could spare the time. And, you know, I think it was Mr. Sheshagiri Narasimhaiah who was the first DG, right? And after his name, I kind
after
of,
director.
Yeah. So I think after that, it would be, you know, your name that I think most Indians would remember in the years to come. Thank you very much, ma'am. We would love to see more great initiatives from NIC in changing the landscape of our country. We are very optimistic about it. One personal says that there has been a lot of trolling on Arogya Setu in terms of privacy and in terms of a lot of other things. I am a product guy. I've built products that people, you know, give feedback. I would, you know, from my side, you know, every comment that came out should only give us more boost in making the product better and making it better. And, you know, with that, I would like to end the session, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone. I really enjoyed talking to all of you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.